God bless you. We're going to move on in our first testimony. We have a testimony service now. And we're moving on to Brother Derek Keel, I think. Brother Derek Keel, yeah. First one to offer up his testimony.
Amen.
All right. That's why the award chain. You ready? All right. Well, real quick, I just wanted to share a testimony. It happened October 18th, about 9:30 p.m. That day. Let me just kind of tell you what proceeded that day. And the gist of the testimony today, as you follow along with me, is it pays to serve the Lord in your time, your resources, and your commitment to God. Because as you follow along with this story, I'm 42 years old now, and I've never had any major incidents in my life. I've had some challenging times, as such as all of us has had. October 18th, around 9:30, earlier that day, my parents were out of town, and I remember I was in a conference that day, downtown at the youth shelter of Tulsa, where Sister Dorothy works. And I got a call that afternoon, about 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock in the morning, that the alarm had went off at the church. And so I came here. When I got here, police were here. Police dogs were in the back. The back door had blown open. It had been a very windy day. And so I went back there. We checked. There was no one there. I secured the building. I went back. Around noon, the alarm code 11, which was a different part of the building, went off. And I kept saying, hey, I'm in a conference. I can't go to each one of these alarms because I'm at work. And so I believe the second or then the third alarm went off at the front, the wind sensor. And so I knew it was a windy day. And so I called Tia, she was off that day. I said, babe, can you just check by the church to make sure things are okay? So we proceeded with that day, and that evening I had moved a kid from a shelter to a different location. And so they told me that we needed to pick up his clothes. And so that night, I remember around 9 o'clock, we were, Tia was a little hungry. We were supposed to be going to Dallas the following day. And I told Tia, I said, let's go get these clothes and we'll grab a bite to eat. And normally, when we go to eat that late, we may go to Jason's Deli, grab something kind of healthy. The boys are normally with us, but this night, we told the boys, we'll be right back. You know, don't worry, we'll bring you something. And so we proceeded, pick up the clothes, and as we left Peoria, Tia wanted to go to Walgreens, and she picked up her items. And so since we were there, I said, babe, before we go back home, let me just check by the church just to make sure everything's okay. Again, you know, pastors were out of town, and so just wanted to make sure things were secured. And I remember going to the back, unlocking the door, and this is the third or fourth incident with the church in one day. And so as we were leaving the parking lot, we were at 36th Street in Cincinnati, at a red light, it says no red turn on right, no right turn on red. And so as we were sitting there, just waiting for the light to turn green, out of nowhere we got hit from the back. A car came rearing into us, going about 45, 50 miles per hour. Didn't brake, hit us 150 feet into the intersection, where normally there would have been east and west traffic coming. And it was like all of a sudden everything happened, and I heard the glass break, I heard the boom, and then I heard the car take off. And through it all, you know, people came to our assistance. Are you okay? I was able to walk out of the accident, and I was trying to start the car up to get out of the intersection because I know it was a dangerous intersection. And so the car wouldn't start, and I said, Tia, let's get out. And she was like, wait. She couldn't get out. And so people came, and she couldn't actually move her left leg. And so as we began to sit there, we began to wonder, you know, what's going on. The person who hit us took off, and the car that they hit us, fortunately, she stalled 300 yards south. But I was just there, and I remember the people who came to our aid, and people were so nice and so friendly. They said, I saw everything. If you need me to be a witness, here's my number. Another person said, here's my number. You can call me. Make sure you document everything. I've had this to happen to me. Make sure you keep a track of everything. And so let me just kind of fast forward as the IMSA came, the first responders were the fire department. As we went to the hospital, I didn't check in as a patient because I was in a little bit of better condition than Tia was. And so I remember as we were walking, as we were riding through the IMSA, and I don't know if you've ever ridden on the IMSA, but though that is the most bumpiest ride in the world. Well, I tell you, if you don't have anything broke while you're on there, you might have to. Anyway, I thank God for the IMSA. Just put a $1,200 bill for that ride. I said, ooh, that's more expensive than a limousine. But anyway, and so as we went, her neck was wrapped up, and I remember Daxton calling to see if it was okay. He was kind of teared up, and I called my in-laws, and I told them what had happened. I told my parents also. They met us at the hospital. But just to kind of fast forward up everything, you guys know, in emergency, 4 or 5 hour away, but I thank God that, you know, as we completed our service at the hospital, Tia was able to walk out. She did have a little pain, she was limping, but I began to think about how the day went, and I began to think about how God had spared my life. And sometimes, how many thank God for second chances? How many thank God for 35, 36, 37, 39 chances? But I believe that as we began to leave the church, I believe God began to show me my life, because firefighters told me, a person who was a firefighter in Tulsa, that at that intersection alone last year, 4 people died. There was a pastor and a bishop that actually died in that same intersection. And I believe God began just to show me that how my work was not finished here on earth. And as he began to show me that, sometimes people say, well, you were lucky that Noah's traffic was coming. No, I wasn't lucky. I was blessed because God's hand was on the whole situation. It was kind of like when you begin to have God's back, I begin to look at it like this. That day, I was taking care of God's business. I was working, but I made sure that God's house was okay. And I believe that as we begin to travel the intersection, and as we got hit, and as we went into the intersection, God's hand, he began to say, I got this. And so he began to rebuke the devourer. And God said he would rebuke the devourer as we would give to him, as we would honor him. That I believe that God's word is true. And through that situation, I believe that God gave me another chance, another perspective to fulfill the call of God on my life. Because had I been killed in an accident, me and my wife had been killed in my accident, my work would not have been finished. And so if you see me walk around, if you see me doing things with a new fire, a new motivation, it's because I do have a second chance, because we might have not walked out and our kids might have been fatherless and motherless. And so I pray to you today in this testimony that you will begin to understand that no matter where you are in your life, your frustrations, your hurt, your disappointments, that as you begin to honor God in your life and what he is depositing in your heart, understand that God is faithful. Come on, say, God is faithful. No matter what man says, what people, sometimes people let us down to our hurt. How many know that? But how many know that God is always faithful? He has never let us down. And even through this situation, you know, we're going through therapy. We go through, we have to go to chiropractic like 3 times a week. And we had to do a settlement on a car. Our car was totaled out. If you saw the pictures. But we have people in our corner that are praying for us. And God has already started working miracles on our behalf in this situation. And so my testimony is that you can't be God-given, number one, and you can't be God-living. Because if you give your life to him, how many know that when, just as a parent, how many know that? How many have kids? Right. A lot of y'all. How many of you that know that all your kids, that you love your kids the same? Right? But you don't always treat them all the same. You know, one act ugly and indignant, you kind of a little bit more firmer with that one than the one that asks you when every time you ask them to do something, they always do it. You love them the same, but sometimes you don't always treat them the same. But how many know that we serve a God that, as you begin, God has an unconditional love for us. No matter what we do, He's always there with His hands and His arms of love and protection all around us. So I thank God for His angels that are camped around about us that fear the Lord. And as we begin to honor the Lord, as we begin to serve the Lord, it always pays to serve the Lord, because you never, ever know what's at the end. And so my testimony is that it always pays to serve the Lord. So no matter where you are in life, whether you're frustrated, whether you're at the point where you say, God, I've traveled all this time in my life, and this is what I have. How many of you know that it's a good day? My mama always used to tell me, it's a good day. Everybody take off your right shoe real quick. I hope your feet don't stay. Take off your right shoe real quick. Just do it real quick and look at your toe. Come on, brother, take your shoe off and look at your toe. And how many of you all see a tag on your toe? Nobody. So I always know it's a good day when you wake up and there's not a tag on your toe. God bless you.
Thank you, brother. You know, I tell you what, Brother Derek, we really need to hear that. About a week or so ago, my wife also was in an accident. And I'll tell you, it is a blessing to know. My main concern when she called me was, hey, is she all right? I mean, that was the biggest concern. And then as she's went through the situation with chiropractors and all, I told my wife, it's not about money or any of that. It's about getting better, getting well, getting well, and being able to thank God that you weren't seriously hurt or even that you're still here with us. Thank you for that, Brother Derek. The next testimony we have is from Brother Walter. You heard Brother Walter singing earlier. I didn't know he did that. Romans 15:1. It's a special one for me.
We Who Are Strong, which is a new international version I'm reading from. We who are strong are to bear with the feelings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Each of us should please his neighbor for his good, to build him up. For even Christ cannot please himself, but as it is written, the insults of those who insult you have fallen on me. For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us.
Yes.
So that, through the endurance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. May the God who gives you endurance and encouragement give you a spirit of unity among yourselves as you follow Christ Jesus. So that with one heart and mouth you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I would always question the Lord. I always do the right thing. I'm always trying to do better.
Amen.
I'm not like my friends. Yeah, I've been out there running around, getting shot at, selling drugs, everything. I did that. I'm not proud of it. I got 3 kids. Guess what? If I continue to do that, what you think they're going to do?
Come on.
Your little sister, your little brother, your little niece,
right,
your little nephew, they are kind of looking up to you. I know slabs is cool, 24s, but is it worth your life? Sitting at the light, chilling, having a good day. Get in your car. Now, some might be a little out of time because I really like that type of stuff. I got the money to buy that type of stuff. But on account of my family and us riding on a good Sunday and somebody told my pride, you're going to kill me and my family or I'm going to kill you, it's not worth it. Not. It's cool, but it's not worth it.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? The world we living in right now is the haves and the have-nots. If you really want to have something, you better follow the Lord.
Amen.
These people can't predict what's going on in the world. You know what I'm saying? They tell you what's going to happen in the world every day, but it's not what they tell you. Look around. All your friends say they got this and they got that. But one day, they might not even show up. And y'all know I'm telling the truth. I know people all up in it, but I talk to youngsters every week. And I see situations. I got a friend. She was just so happy out of town. This little murder just happened last week. That might have been her.
Come on.
She didn't even want to go. It's a hurricane on the East Coast. But she on a plane headed to Virginia. Spared her life. That's the Lord.
Amen.
Hey, don't wait till it's too late. Don't wait till you're in a sticky situation. I'm going to tell you, you'll have to do facing the Lord while you're going in 25 to life. You don't want to face the Lord behind the bars because it's painful. You ain't got your family then. You don't have those then. The freedom don't have it. Take the time now. It ain't got to be just, you doing it every day and just throwing it up in people's face. Stay who you are, but incorporate the Lord in your life.
Amen.
That's what makes the believers, the real believers, who you are. I can't change me and everything that I've been through. I always ask the Lord, why me? My body's been sick since I was 12, 13 years old, in and out of the hospital. He's 55, amputee, diabetic, heart attacks, multiple, strokes, multiple, still here. Try to get them to see the same thing. That you're here for a reason. Nobody's about it. 55 years old.
Amen.
Where y'all heard that at? 2 heart attacks, 3 strokes, triple bypass. Can't live, come back. I gotta sit in the hospital night after night because nobody wanna go. I got older brothers and sisters, nobody wants to go.
Come on.
I'm missing school, sitting in the hospital on my dad's side, wondering why. Why me, Lord? I'm at A's and B's. I go to practice. I'm in the band. I do what I'm supposed to do. Romans 15:1. You must bear the infirmities of the weak.
Come on.
You can't be bearing the infirmities of the weak as a weak person. You must be strong, so stand tall and have faith in the Lord.
Amen.
God-wise is much better to be than being street-wise.
That's right.
Walters that I just have to say something short about Willie Walters. One day I was riding down 46th Street. Man, I was feeling down. I'm not going to tell you, lie to you. I was feeling really kind of down that day. And I looked up and I looked at the church and I said, and it was Brother Walter cutting the yard. And I mean, it was hot. The summer was hot. It was hot. I looked over and saw Brother Walter cutting the yard. And I'll tell you, my spirit just went sky high. I mean, young guy out there doing it. Where he could have been anywhere else. Could have been doing anything else. But he was out there cutting the yard by himself. You know, this is a yard. I don't know how much, but it's a yard. And so it just lifted my spirit that day. And ever since then, I always want to make it my thing to go and speak to him and give a little of that young wisdom. Now next, coming to the stage for a testimony is Brother John Dorsey.
Saturday morning was the last day of a 40-day consecration that the Lord gave me. And the Lord, He blessed me with His gift. And during that time, the Lord, He will show Himself to you. He will reveal and open up the scriptures to you. I mean, when He does that, it's exciting and it's frightening.
Yeah.
And let's see. Let's try to get this together. When He opened up the scriptures to you, and you're reading the scriptures, and the revelation from the scriptures jump out. It jumps out, and it's like it jumps into you. It jumps. And when you read the scriptures out loud, it feels like you're getting full. Although you're still hungry. And the Lord is just so special. And you find out that the Lord, He is both wonderful and horrible.
Yes.
He is wonderful in His mercy.
Yes.
He is horrible in His wrath.
Come on.
Horrible.
Yes.
And the way this, I'll tell you a little bit how the way this got started. I would hear and read certain scriptures, and these scriptures were irritating. They were irritating, you know. And let me just give you just a few of them.
Come on.
If I can get somebody to find it and read it for me. The first one is Proverbs 14:12. If I can get someone to read it kind of loud. Also, during this time of consecration, the Lord took a little over 60 pounds off me. It's 60 pounds in 40 days with no exercise. And you feel great. You're really wonderful. Okay, someone read that.
There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death.
Amen. Yes, that's one of those irritating scriptures. It was irritating. Also, another scripture is Ezekiel 3:18. That's another scripture that would irritate me.
if thou warn the wicked, and he turn not from his wickedness, nor from his wicked way, he shall die in his iniquity. But thou hast delivered thy soul.
That's it.
That's good.
And also there's one that says, his blood I shall require at your hands. Yeah. Now for years I would hear that. His blood, you don't want the wicked, his blood I'm going to require at your hands. Mm. And I would think, man, I really didn't know what it means, but the interpretation I got from it, now I could be wrong. If I'm wrong, y'all can correct me. But I take that as God is saying, if you don't mourn the wicked, his blood is going to be required at your hand. That's the same as God saying, I'm going to treat you as if you murdered that person.
Come on.
And we know the murderer shall get in and inherit the kingdom of God.
That's right.
That's how I interpret the scripture that. And then we're like, oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God.
My.
And there's another scripture. Matthew 7, 13 and 14. It's 13 and 14.
Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. Mm. And many there be which go in thereat.
Yes,
because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it.
Now, when I would go over these scriptures, I had said to Jesus, I said it in my heart, but it really didn't make any difference. I said to Jesus, Lord, if it is so hard to get into heaven, what did you come and die for? What did you come and die for? And then the Lord said to me, you get out of your flesh,
come on.
And then you come back and ask me that question. Now, it was about a couple of weeks after that. It was a few days before the first of, what was it? October. Okay. So then he came and presented to me, saying, you're going to be fasting. You're going to be fasting starting first. Now this was just a few days before the first. I said, okay. So he said, 40 days. He said, 40 days. I said, okay, Lord. He gave me determination. I said, Lord, I'm going to do this or I'm going to die trying. Okay, so I didn't prepare for the fast like you're supposed to. I was eating full meals, right up until that day. I was eating full meals, no preparation. And when the Lord came, it felt as if he just put the consecration down, covered me with it. And I was fasting. And I would pray. Lord, could you please make this go fast? Could you please make this pass by fast? Alright. And, okay. The Lord would reveal things to me. He'd say, your flesh and the devil are best friends. Flesh and the devil are best friends. God did not design the flesh to lead. It was not made to lead. And the flesh loves all the suggestions of the devil. They are best friends. Now God gave me the gift, I call it the gift of the 40-day consecration. and the flesh, in a heartbeat, will gladly give that gift to Satan. The flesh loves Satan, and the flesh hates God. If you let the flesh, give that gift away, you'll give it if you let it. Okay. And as the fast went on, everybody getting ready for the temptations. The temptations to eat. Oh, God. I remember during the fast, we were taking a family member, taking them to the little shopping and stuff. What y'all eating tonight? I don't want to tell nobody I'm fasting because I don't want it to seem like you're trying to seek vain glory or nothing like that. And I'm just doing it today because this is what he wants me to do. I said, well, Pearl's going to have some sandwiches. She's going to do that. And we're going to go home and do that. Okay. All right. You want some pizza? You're going to buy Zio's. You want some pizza? No, and I love pizza. I love pizza. I can have pizza for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. I love pizza. No, we're good. Then we had someone else come over to the house. They had 3 boxes of pizza in their car. Oh, John, you want some? No, I'm good. I mean, the enemy is trying to tempt your flesh into giving that gift away. Then we had someone else bring some food. Oh, it was cold. She brought over some neck bones and cabbage. She had some brown beans and some homemade cornbread rolls from scratch. And she's known in my family as a great cook. And it was like, oh God. And it's like, I watched Pearl eat that for 2 days. And it was it'll try to make you feel so left out. You feel so foolish. But you know God is working something. God is working something in you. He told me that when you hear a scripture and the scripture is irritating, God is taking that scripture like a switch.
Come on.
And he's swapping you with spot. Warn the wicked. Spot. Warn the wicked. Spot. That's exactly what's happening. You're getting a whoop. That's what that means. And Jesus, that's, it's just really wonderful. Really wonderful. God has a sense of humor. I remember 20 days had went by. And he said, John, it's been 20 days. Is that quick enough? Oh, Lord. That's 28th day, our family got together, when I'm saying family, I mean brothers and sisters from out of towns, and we had gone to ongoing service. And of course, I'm videotaping. And of course, they're going to go back and eat. So I go back and I'm videotaping. And they got food all over. I mean, everything you like. Green beans and macaroni and cheese, and baked beans and chicken. It was just all this food. And I'm looking at it, and God, he gave me the grace to resist all of it.
Amen.
To resist it all. Jesus. When the Lord approaches you, he's coming.
Yes.
He's going to offer you this gift. You know, the scripture says, grace and peace will be multiplied to you through the knowledge. That's one way to get grace. Humbling yourself before God is another way, is a major way. It's a major way to get grace. And God says about the 2- and 3-day fast, God says that's wonderful. He loves it. He says, but you're just in the water to your ankles. He says, come into the deep. Come into the deep. And I'll leave this with you. God has an island. And the name of this island is Great Grace. And it is surrounded with the waters of consecration and prayer and fasting and seeking His face. And the only way you're going to get to this island is you swim across.
Yes.
You've got to swim across. You've got to swim across. And when we do the 2- and 3-day fast, you just step in the water to your ankles. And the Lord says that's wonderful. But He says, come on. Come on over. Come on over to the island so you can receive My grace. So you can minister to people the right way. You can minister to them acceptably. You can use My grace to help you minister to the lost. And I noticed that during this time, some of my friends would come over, they start looking at you crazy. You know, you'd be kind of going through the store, people kind of look at you crazy. Man, I ain't did nothing. I just... Let's be encouraging, guys.
Yes.
When God approaches you, you tell Him, yes, Lord. And give me the determination that I'm going to do this or I'm going to die trying. And He will reward you. And He will draw you closer to Himself.
Yes.
Your fellowship will be so sweet. All you want to do is take God's hand and run away with Him and hide from everybody and everything. That's what this gift will do for you. That's it, my
friend. Oh boy. Brother John, you're a bigger guy than I am, and I really felt bad sitting there because 2 weeks ago or so, Pastor admonished us to fast for 2 or 3 days, I guess it was, and I think I shared this with somebody the day my wife had the accident. I was in Walmart, and I was trying to resist, but boy, those hot wings was calling me, so I picked up a few of them and walked up to the counter to check out. Who did I see standing at the end of the line? Pastor. You talking about somebody dunking into that? John, after what you did. We have another testimony, you guys. I'm going to bring this gentleman up, Brother Curtis. Come up. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
God bless everybody.
Amen.
I'm leaving something good for everyone.
Yeah.
I give honor to God first in my life, to Mother Hill and Pastor Hill, and everyone who's here today. I got a testimony to something like Brother Derek. First, I got up this morning to ask the good Lord, anything that one have to speak about today, let me receive it.
Yes.
Because you never know if you need to receive it or not. If you come in with your heart shut down, your soul shut down, your mind shut down, you're not going to receive anything.
That's right.
But if you come in with an open mind, open soul, and ready to receive it, God will give you whatever you have to get to receive. So I said, God, let me receive it. Every last one of these testimonies so far was dynamite. dynamite. Yeah. They wasn't awesome, they was dynamite.
Yeah.
So I said, God, I'm serious. What Brother Gary has spoke about today is my same testimony. I said, I want to have a good fight before I leave this earth.
Yes.
And I definitely want to finish that finish line.
Yes.
I don't want to have the devil put me out of order. Uh-huh. And my testimony is on today. Last Sunday, I went down to the fellowship hall. The lady restroom, the man restroom had out of order. That's what the good Lord tried to put me out of order. So I called Pastor Hill and Mother Hill downstairs and said, Mother, what's wrong with the restroom? She said, Brother Curtis, I don't know right now, but I can have my husband call me. I said, okay. Pastor Hill called me. He said, Brother Curtis, we need to fix the toilet. I'm just making a long story short. I said, okay. I went by there Monday to pick up the stuff he had for me, but my body wasn't feeling good, but I kept trying to, so like you say, fight a good fight.
Come on.
I kept going, but all of a sudden my body laid down. Tuesday, I tried to get up and go to work. I couldn't. I went to work, but one of my workers had to bring me back home because I couldn't drive. The lady was talking so much, in my mind, I was saying, Lord, be quiet, because my body was hurting that bad. So when I got to the house, the first thing I was thinking, I said, Lord, I'm not finished my work yet. You know, I ain't finished. I laid on the bed, seemed like I was just drifting away. I said, I didn't put that bill on the toilet for Pastor Hill. I was just still drifting away. So I said, Darrell, I need to go to the hospital. I'm serious, my body was hurting that bad. And the more I laid on the bed, it seemed like more I was just drifting away from this earth. Drifting away. So the good Lord just came to me and just kept me up. I mean, just all of a sudden, really, he just gave me strength back in my body. But the first thing, it seemed like, I don't know who was telling me, what he was telling me. You have a lot of souls tags.
Come on.
A lot of souls tags in your life where you cannot hear from me. When you got a lot of souls tags in your life, you can't hear from God. I got so much work. I got so much bills. I got so much employees to worry about. I got all of these things to worry about. Them are souls tags.
Yeah.
Get rid of all of your souls tags, Curtis. Get rid of them. Once I started to say, hey, I need to get rid of these souls tags because I want to fight a good fight. How can I fight a good fight when I got all of these weight on me?
Come on.
I got a lot of weight on me.
Come on.
When you got a lot of weight and sin in your life, how can you hear from God?
Yeah.
You can't hear from God because you got so much distraction in your mind. But when you clear all of them things from your mind, clear everything.
Yeah.
God, you can hear from God. You can hear from God. When you got the devil on this ear and God on this ear, which one you want to hear first?
Yeah.
Most people going to hear this. You're not going to hear God. But when you get deep running to God and get all of them soul ties out of your life, all the little bitty things. You got to read. I have a lot of little bitty things. So while I was laying in that bed, he'd give me strength. I said, Lord, take this from me.
Come on.
Take this from me.
Come on.
But I just want to tell him, take this day because he's giving me strength.
Yes.
Take it away for good.
Yes.
A lot of times, Pastor Hill said, go win some souls. I have so many people in my life. So many people in my life. I see so many people. Just like Brother Butler said, you know, if you win a soul, they don't have to come here. That's just a soul you want.
Yeah.
Just long you win that soul, they don't have to come here.
Come on.
Just long you win a soul.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter what church they go to, because when we go up, we going up together.
Come on.
We're not going up to Billy Bob Church or Sister Bob Church.
Yeah.
We all going up to God.
Yeah.
And God is one God.
Yeah.
See, he is one God. So he's giving me all of these things. So I'm saying, God, how awesome you is. You continue to bless me. You continue to, bless me in ways that I'm not deserve these blessings.
Come on.
I'm not deserving. He blessed me so good right now that I say, God, thank you.
Yay.
I'm doing some work right now for banks that I get very good money now.
Come on.
I'm not going to say an amount. Because when I get out of church, I don't want you to come and ask me for a loan. But I said, thank God. But I don't deserve it. But God is so loving, so kind, so sweet, so patient.
Yeah.
For all of these things he's given us, how can I ever turn my back but winning souls.
Yeah.
So I say, God, give me a man. Give me a revenue. Just give me something how to go approach a person the right way. Give them that sweet, kind way to say, hey, come on in. Look what you're missing.
Come on.
Look what you're missing, what God has for you.
Yeah.
Look what you're missing. So he gave me a second, third, Brother Derek, 50, 60, all these chances. So I said, now it's my time. I'm 51 years old, but now it's time for me to go and get someone in this church or yeah. someone else's church.
Yeah.
So I'm saying, hey, I'm not out of order. Pastor Hill, the tallest is fixed. So we back in order now.
Yeah.
It's back in order now.
Yeah.
So I'm saying, I'm going to fight a good fight. I will finish this race.
Yeah.
Tell me, I will finish this race.
Yeah.
God bless you.
Thank you, brother. Moving on through, right now we're at the point of announcements and welcoming my visitors. We got Brother Rob to be up for us today.
Amen.
Yes, Brother Rob.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
You can't be too mad because you woke up this morning, so good morning. All right. Let's start off with a little bit here. Let's talk about prayer. Remember your personal prayer times, as well as our corporate prayer times here at church. Please remember to try to devote at least 1 hour. I think Pastor asked us to do that some time ago, so please remember to try to adhere to that, as well as doing more than 1 hour. Also, I would like to mention to you that coming this Tuesday night, is Mary Ann here? I didn't see you earlier. Mary Ann Alexander is going to be putting on a seminar of How Money Works. That is going to be held on November 13th, actually, from 6:30 to 7:45 p.m. at the French Villa Clubhouse that is located at 4744 South Harbor. So if you're needing some good financial advice, those of you that know Mary Ann, you know that she is within that realm of activity. So if you need any further information, contact her. Parking is also available there on the south side of the villa, directly across from the Harvard Towers, and where the Spirit Bank is located. So if you need any further information, get a hold of Mary Ann, if you will, please. All right, as you know, next Sunday, we are going to be having our family dinner here at the church after service, so please stick around. So make sure that you bring your appetite. I will definitely bring mine. So please stay after church and enjoy that as well. Let's see. Last week, I believe Brother Ife had his ensemble concert at ORU.
Yeah.
And Brother John has so graciously put that on YouTube. So you can go out there and look at that as well. So I plan to go do that. I'm sorry I couldn't make it there, Brother Ife, but I will check it out. Let's talk a little bit about some of our visitors here. I've got three visitors cards, so I hope I include all of you all here. I've got, is it Montrell Howard? If you would stand up, please, Montrell.
Amen.
LaDuane Drew, I hope I didn't mess up your name. If you would stand up too, please.
Amen.
And Christian Owens. All right, if you will stand up, please. Everybody, if you would, let's take a few moments. Let's go greet them real quickly. Make them feel at home. And let's just make sure that we are thankful that you are here. We're grateful that you came. You would definitely like me to come back again. God, to get to know God. That's why you are here.
Amen.
Do not think that it was a mistake. You're at the right place, at the right time, with the right people. So we want to make sure. Don't be mad because God gave you another day of life. Don't be upset because you're here to serve Him. Let's do what we came to do today. Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Rob. Thank you. Well, we should point in our service that you know, Brother Derek, he said something earlier, and it kind of stuck with me a little bit. Brother Derek talked about coming back to the church one night and checking, or one day, and checking to make sure that the church is safe. And, you know, with the next part of our service, I think about that a lot. Coming to the church here, you know, we're able to pull up into a nice parking lot. It's really in good shape. We have a beautiful building here. And Brother Curtis talked about him coming in and fixing things. And, you know, we're able to come to church on Sunday and any other day that we come to the church, the lights are on.
Yes.
And everything, I mean, this is just a comfortable place to come and praise the Lord.
Amen.
And in saying that, I'm going to bring up Pastor Williams, one of our esteemed pastors here. And he'll lead us in our giving ceremony.
Thank you, brother. Let's give a little hand. And I have all the testimonies of other brothers. And see if we can walk through very quickly the Proverbs, the third chapter. If you have it, let's just walk through that very, very quick. Because hearing these testimonies kind of reminded me, and with the day today being Veterans Day, kind of reminded me when I was serving in a career, in Seoul, career, just very, very close to the DMZ, just about 25 miles out of being communist territory. And I saw a lot of faith in military men. You'd be surprised how your faith grows when your life is close to the line and people kind of depend on God a little bit more. So I kind of, as a young man, brought me a jacket over there and had embroidered on the back of it. Proverbs, the third chapter, verse 5. You have it there, say amen.
Amen.
And on the back of my jacket, I kept that jacket for a number of years. It said, trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thy own. What does it say there?
Understanding.
And also verse 6 I had on there also, in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. So out on the back of my jacket, I was gave me confidence to walk around in the village. Also on base, and got comfortable with the Koreans and learned how to speak a little bit of Korean. How many, anybody here know a little bit of Korean? Brother McLean, why are you? Kansamida. Hello, how are you today? And that's only the men would say that, but the women would say Chamaneo or something like that. That's how the women would respond. So they have this way that you speak. Some things men say, some things women just say, okay? Then I'll let y'all on, y'all get bored if you don't know my language. But this is the deal. I learned how to have confidence in the scripture by having it on the back of my jacket all the time. And now, as I have grown and got older in the Lord, sometimes you heard me say, I've been young, now I'm getting older. And I've never seen the righteous sister forsaken, nor received bread for bread. So you have to live those years to be able to say that with conviction. Never seen God forsake his people. Never seen them have to beg for bread under all in any situation. So I learned to trust in him. So money I don't get uptight with. Sometimes in church circles people get uptight when you start talking about money and offerings. But here's a necessary deal. Money is necessary for the church. And as Derek was surveying and keeping surveillance on the church property, making sure no one had broken in here, taking care of God's house. And as you see, somewhere in that Proverbs, it says to do something with your money. I think that might be
It says, honor the Lord, verse 9, with your substance.
Yes, yes.
That's what I learned to do as a young person. Honor the Lord with my substance, with what you have. He didn't say you have to have a whole lot, but what you have, you need to honor the Lord with that. So tithing and offerings, as long as I've been saved, I have always been a tither. How about you? And any tither would know, I can tell you right away, if you are a tither, you know that God honors that.
Amen. That's right.
There's no question about it. You know that. But then we go beyond tithing, we go into offerings. And this is a part that sustains the functionality of God's house or his ministry. And that's the pastor and all of the support and all of those kind of things make up God's house. So if you honor the Lord with your substance is actually your offering. So you have to, we want to do that, honor the Lord with our substance. And the first fruits is always, you know, that is tithing, amen?
Amen.
That's first 10% off everything, the top, the first, that's the tithe. But substance, so we have to honor the Lord with our substance. And I want to tell you that it's not really fair for one man to kind of take care of the functionality of God's house. Just not. Even though he would be willing to do it, it just wouldn't be right for that to happen. So we have to kind of, and sometimes I don't even share those burdens with us enough, I don't think, as to, you know, how's the finances, how things going. I'm sure they keep a lot of that stuff to themselves. And that's why they should go on vacation. Not to their garage, but to Hawaii. We're going to go in December, so they need to go and get away from all of this stuff. How many have stuff at home? Yes, oh, OMG, I don't want that stuff. Some of us don't deal with it. How much you got to deal with it? Praise God. So here's what I'm saying to you. Let's take some of the pressure off of them, and particularly as much as we can, through pastoral offerings or what have you, so they can deal with stuff at the church. It happens in the house. I heard Pastor Gil say the other day, he ran out of gas. Someone said, well, I'm glad they can see my preacher walking with a gas can. I'm like James Churchill. Who's that? A preacher over there with a gas can walking down the street. I mean, that's not good. That would be a reflection on me. You know that? So let's start today, pastoral offerings. I know there's a need for about $500. I don't know if we'll get it or not, but we got to get close. And this is the substance side of the house. Offering. The offering. So enough of us in here to need to come up with a couple of thousand if we really wanted to.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Man, I know I got to get some tires in my car, and it's just like 400 plus. Just, and you know, think I'm gonna mess around with that? No, I'm gonna get some wet tires. Gotta have them, praise God. So things that we know that we want to do when we have to do, we can do it. So money's not really what the issue is, whether we want to or not. I can drive on some of those. What do you call those tires from the very ball, brother?
Maypot.
Yeah, Maypot. Not me. I ain't going for no Maypot. Praise God. When I put some tires on there, they're going to be what?
Great,
good tires. We're going to make them. So we want you to reach in and find some substance and bring it to the house of the Lord and give it an honor of your pastor. Can you do that?
Amen.
Can we do that?
Amen.
I know we're generous. We've already sent them to Hawaii. And she says in December. No telling where we'll send them in June. And you have that kind of mind and attitude that says, if you honor the Lord with your substance, you'll be all right.
Amen.
That's what I've learned over the years. If I learn, if I do that, I'm okay.
Amen.
So I'm in business as a businessman all myself, and I depend on me, myself, and the Lord, nobody else. I don't have to worry about no one. I don't have a punch-in clock or anything like that. So I don't worry. Guess what? I always look back at my record and say, How have I been doing with the tithe and the what? The substance. Mm-hmm. Never seen the righteous one.
Forsaken.
Or his seed do what?
Beg for bread.
Hallelujah. So that's when you get tough like that with your faith, you can go anywhere and do anything you want in life. And write your own ticket. How many agree with me? That's just raw. That's just raw reality. So I want you to write a check, Northside Christian Center, pastoral offering, and collectively, let's get it up to that amount of money. Praise God. You know, if you listen to the Lord, if he says write a $5 check, if that was the Lord, you would write a what? But if he said write a $50 check, could you still hear him?
Yes.
Could you still hear him?
Yes.
Some of us in here, he said write a $50 check. He's only one or two of us, he told to write a $5 check. That would be Christopher and Bradley. And Bradley could write one. Christopher could too. Don't get it wrong. Like their dad said, keep it straight. Those boys know money. They can write a check if they want to. Okay, so let's stand and have prayer. We will praise God. Let's be a blessing. Let's be a blessing. Let's bring in the tithe. Let's bring in the offering. Let's be a blessing. Honor the Lord with your substance, with the first fruits of all your increase. Father, we thank you today for your kindness that's toward us. We thank you that you love us. Hallelujah. You love us so much that you gave your only begotten Son. And we thank you, Father, that your plans for us are good plans. Hallelujah. We give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Let the church say amen. God bless you. Please bring